We're ready to start. Let's start with prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray your blessings this day in our study, that you might grant us understanding from your word, and that you might help us bear witness of you in this world with our lives. For Jesus' sake, amen. All right, Romans chapter 13. Now, last week we discussed the first part of Romans 13, which deals with government. Let every soul be subject to governing authorities. We discussed a little bit on the limits of that. It does not mean blind obedience to everything government says. That what Paul is saying means lawful government. And it means government exercising itself within the roles that God gave it, namely to promote good and protect the people and to punish evil. That is the function of government. And that when government tries to force people to promote evil, and when it punishes good, then we do not owe government our obedience. We owe God our obedience first. So that was the discussion last week. Any comments or questions that percolated up during the week that you want to address before we move on? All right. So, when we ended last week, we ended with the questions on the handout. So, where does that leave us with our government? And does our government promote sin and punish good? That is the exact opposite of what God commands. And in some places, it does. When it comes to the protection of murdering babies, it's promoting evil and punishing good, destroying life. When it comes to promoting sexual immorality, homosexual marriage, things like this, our government promotes evil and threatens to punish godly people who object. So our government does, in fact, do the opposite in places of what God has given it to do. And in those places where it's not functioning as it's in its God-given role as government, we as Christians have a duty to resist it, to disagree with it and resist it and not go along. So we do not owe blind obedience to government. And on top of that, what we didn't get to last week is the fact that our system of government in particular has bound itself to another level of law, if you will, that it has to abide by, that's supposed to be a guarantee for us so that we obey as long as it stays within that structure, and that's the Constitution. So should our government suddenly decide to jettison the Constitution and enforce laws contrary to laws that it should be bound to by its own admission, then again, as Christians, we are not bound to just blindly obey. All right. So, let's move on now. Verse 8, chapter 13, Romans. Verses 8 through 13 will hit. So, 8, owe no one anything except to love one another, for he who loves another has fulfilled the law. Let's read 9 and 10 too. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, you shall not covet. And if there's any other commandment, these are summed up in this saying, namely, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfillment of the law. All right, to begin with, verse 8, owe no one anything except to love one another. Owe no one anything. The point seems to be avoiding situations that can cause conflict. Love is Paul's point. Sometimes there are certain barriers we put up to love. And owing people something can be one of those barriers. There are several things in the Old Testament telling people, don't be a borrower, avoid borrowing. Why not be a borrower? Well, because sometimes when you borrow somebody's stuff, they break. Like the time I borrowed Robert Winter's trailer with had four tires when I left and brought it back with three. Borrowing can cause problems sometimes, especially when the borrower breaks and then doesn't want to fix or replace what he borrowed. So at any rate, there's actually Old Testament laws about this. If you want to just take a quick peek in Exodus 22. And the point being that this is something that does get in the way of being able to love one another as God has given us commands, so it's best not to if you can avoid it. Exodus 22, 9 to 15 is a whole list of various things about what to do if somebody borrows your stuff, and it, like, especially animals, and they happen to die. So, like, verse 9, for any kind of trespass, whether concerning an ox, a donkey, a sheep, clothing, any kind of lost thing, which another claims to be his, the cause of both parties shall come before the judges, and whomever the judges condemn shall pay double to his neighbor. If a man delivers to his neighbor a donkey, an ox, a sheep, or any animal to keep, and it dies, is hurt, or driven away, no one seeing it, then the oath of the Lord shall be between them both, that he has not put his hand into his neighbor's goods, and the owner of it shall accept that, and he shall not make it good. But if, in fact, it is stolen from him, he shall make restitution to the owner of it. If it's torn to pieces by any beast, then he shall bring it as evidence, and he shall not make good what was torn. And if a man borrows anything from his neighbor, and it becomes injured or dies, the owner of it, not being with it, he shall surely make it good. If its owner was with it, he shall not make it good. If it was hired, it came for its hire. So there's a list of things, what to do if something is borrowed or given or dies in the whole works. So avoid situations that are going to complicate love. It seems to be the point. And then he launches into this love is the fulfillment of the law thing. It is interesting, owe no one anything except love, which really, when you think about it, makes love a matter of debt. Love is something owed. Owe no one anything except love. On the handout here, it's the exact opposite of the way the world thinks. You know, to the world, love is something earned. To God, love is something owed. It's a debt to be paid. So, yeah, it's moreover, it's owed out of a debt to God, not because of a debt to other people. Going on. The very end of verse 9, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Important quotation showing that love of others is kind of a form of love of self. It's also said of husbands and wives in Ephesians 5 that the husband ought to love his wife as himself. So love of self is a natural instinct. It is not seen as a work we have to force ourselves to do. It's also so much a part of living, we don't need rewards or affirmation when we love ourselves. It comes naturally. You don't even have to be told to love yourself. So this is the nature of our love for others, too. It should be the sort of thing that just comes so naturally. We don't have to be told, and we aren't looking for affirmation, aren't looking for rewards. It's something we owe to God. On love and the law on the handout. It talks about verse 10 here, love is the fulfillment of the law. This is a direct quote of Jesus from Matthew 22. You take a quick peek at that. Matthew chapter 22, verse 34 to 40. Matthew 22, 34 to 40. And when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. Then one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question, testing him and saying, "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." So the law is about love of God and love of neighbor. Love is the fulfillment of the law. Now, back on the handout, the point is made here. Obedience to the law, as taught by the rabbis, came from a sense of duty, responsibility, and even fear. Christ taught that obedience is an expression of love. This is a radically different way of understanding the law, important to parenting as well. That is, a parent looks for children to obey his or her laws because you love them and they love you, not because there's a threat hanging over your head if you don't. Love is the fulfillment of the law. Love does no harm to a neighbor. Something else said here. Something to remember, especially in conversation with others. Words can do harm. Sometimes we may say things innocently and give an offense we didn't intend. Other times we intentionally hurt with words by scolding unjustly, insulting, or passive-aggressive comments. However, when others take offense and play hurt by God's truth, we are bound by the law of love to God, not to people's feelings. So even when we are thinking words, we need to be thinking in terms of love. That means not taking offense at everything and not trying to give offense. So these were especially important principles for the Roman Christians to practice among themselves because of the conflict between the Jewish converts and the Gentile converts. Remember, Rome was a troubled congregation. There was a division within the Roman congregation. There were Jewish converts, there were Gentile converts, and the two fought. And the Jewish converts were accusing the Gentile converts of not being good Christians because they weren't keeping all the laws. And the Gentile converts were accusing the Jewish converts of being thrown out by God and cast away because they weren't good people, and now God loved them instead. So there's a war going on. So Paul is focusing on love as the solution to bring peace to their conflict. Any questions or thoughts before we move to the next verses? Verse 11 then, and 12a. "And do this, knowing the time, that now it is high time to wake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand." So as the handout says, there's a certain Christian sense of urgency about living out the faith. Love cannot be put off because there may not be the same opportunities later. Life changes quickly. So seize the day is very much a Christian principle. The time is now. You know, in this conflict happening there in Rome, it's basically get over yourselves and stop behaving like this and show the love that Christ has given you to show it now. Quit making excuses and putting things off. Verse 12b, "Therefore let us cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lusts." So he repeats himself several times here. The casting off the works of darkness, the putting on the armor of light, walking properly, It's kind of all saying the same thing over and over again for the sake of emphasis. Do this now. The Roman Christians had been imitating the world around them with how they were treating each other. Paul also acknowledges the threat of imitating the world's lusts. So not only the way they were treating each other, but also how they were copying the world in other ways. Quit copying the world. You're not of the world. So put off the things of the world. The revelry and drunkenness have to do, again, with self-serving sins. Lewdness and lust, sexual sins. Strife and envy, sins against other people. And then this rather strange saying, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, not believe in Jesus, not commit yourself to Jesus or decide to follow Jesus, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Put on, you see the Greek word, bottom of page one, it means to clothe, literally, to enter into or sink into even. It's from two Greek words, en and duno. So en means in, duno is to sink into. So basically, sink into. So put on Christ like you're surrounding yourself with a garment. It's a fascinating way to talk about faith. Faith isn't about keeping laws. It's not about doing a certain thing. Let Christ surround you. Sink into Christ. It's a profound way of talking about what faith is. Luther was always fond, too, of speaking of being Christ to one another. Looking at the other person as Christ and serving them for Christ's sake. And then being Christ to others, making yourself sacrificial in the way that you treat other people. Giving up of yourself, your time, your effort, everything, your life if need be. That's being Christ, loving at the expense of self. Yes?
Something that I learned, that when things are going really bad in life, that's when I have to not run to other things to try to calm myself, other people, other things. And that's when I really need to praise God, worship Him, sing to Him, and know that I have to hold on to His hand as hard and as tight as I can. And that's something that I'm learning that's brand new, because I was really good at doing the trusting God and you know, praising Him when things would go right. It was when things would go wrong that I would run to all the wrong things. And learning now to just hold on to Him and not just cry out to Him, but to praise Him in those really hard moments. That's what's become so amazing.
Yeah, the putting on Christ thing is,
I mean, what the context that Paul is using that expression is in the midst of a conflict. You know, it's not just put Him on in the good times. It's like you say, it's in conflicted times. To truly make the effort to be Christ to others and see Christ in others. To serve God by serving them and giving of oneself. Yeah. So the difficult times really is what makes the Christian the Christian. And it sets him apart from the world around, which it's always easy to see the silver lining in the when it's not raining. All right. Also on the handout, top of page two here, a couple of other Greek words. Something he says about making no provision for the flesh, verse 14. The word provision literally means foresight, forethought, providing for providence. So advance knowledge. In other words, don't dwell on things that are contrary to God. Make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lusts. Don't sit around and think about evil things. Don't plan out, dwell on, devote your mental time to these things which are contrary to God. So it speaks to premeditation, planning, mentally focusing on evil things. It's the mental sin prior to the sinful act. And in that sense, it's something akin to covetousness, because covetousness is the mental sin that happens prior to stealing, or prior to idolatry even, or adultery. You covet another person. So even the mind, this putting on Christ thing, affects your thought process, not just your acts. Don't dwell on evil things. All right, so kind of this whole list of ways to behave that are expressions of putting on Christ. That's not just about behavior. It's about Christ living through us towards others. Chapter 14, verse 1. Receive one who is weak in the faith, but not to disputes over doubtful things. Christological compassion for the spiritually weak. Helping the weak in faith is the heart of the gospel. God came to us in our sinful weakness to give us Christ's strength over sin and temptation. He is and he was gentle and patient with us. So Paul makes this clear distinction, though, between this kind of Christ compassion and the kind that would open itself up to the spiritually weak by arguing with them over their spiritual religious bugaboos. And you cannot convince people of truth by arguing them into it. And that's kind of where Paul goes with this. Receive somebody who's weak in the faith, but not to disputes over doubtful things. So yeah, you see somebody struggling with the faith, having an issue, something that bothers them or whatever, help them. Guide them, be patient with them, point them to God's word, but don't try and help them and wind up in a big religious argument. Sometimes those things happen and you can't avoid them. But you can never argue somebody into the faith, ever. You can make your case clearly. You can speak the truth, whether they hear it or not, is the Holy Spirit's work, not yours. But don't get into disputes about doubtful things, things that are not clearly biblically spelled out, things that really don't matter in the scheme of things. Stick with what matters. So disputing is the caution here. And this does not mean that teachers and those with understanding should not offer a word to the wise where appropriate. It just means don't let the thing degenerate into a fight. Which also was happening in Rome, by the way, between the Christians. 2, for one believes he may eat all things, but he who is weak eats only vegetables. 3, let not him who eats despise him who does not eat, and let not him who does not eat judge him who eats, for God has received them. So here's Paul's first example of a thing that is not a biblical truth, really, but that becomes a biblical truth for some people, and they try and get into arguments about it. There were groups who didn't eat meat, who ate only vegetables. That's still a thing. There are those who see a problem with eating meat. Does that mean they can't be Christian or brought into the church? Well, of course not. It's just, this is not something God has commanded or forbidden. If they want to live in a certain way where God hasn't commanded or forbidden, we have Christian freedom to do so. So somebody who doesn't want to eat meat, fine, don't eat meat. Those who do shouldn't ride their case and tell them they're doing something wrong because of that. Nor should they assume to tell people who do eat meat that they're doing something wrong. Now, of course, when you get into a situation where you've got people who don't eat meat because they think there's something wrong with eating meat, then that does create a certain problem. If they're just doing it out of their own taste or spiritual discipline, that's one thing. But if they're trying to enforce a view on others and make a law that God hasn't made, like there's something wrong with killing animals, therefore you shouldn't eat meat, you know, in that case, we have to stand up for truth. It's not a matter of us respecting their views, it's a matter of them making their views into a law of God, which is not a law. And in that case, we have an obligation to resist a false teaching. But a personal practice, that we should respect. Yes.
Doesn't it say that God put animals on earth for us to have dominion over?
Yes, it certainly does.
Wouldn't that fall into that category?
You could certainly see where it would be included in that category. But dominion can also,
I think, means management more than it means consumption. But sometimes you consume in order to manage, you know. So, yeah. There's plenty of biblical evidence where God doesn't have a problem with us eating meat. And as long as somebody doesn't come along saying that there is a problem with it, we should let them do what they want to do and not question it.
Why do the Jewish people have... And Muslim, too, really have their own brand of kosher.
They do. You'll never see a kosher pig slaughtering house, though. That is right. That is kind of an Old Testament thing where priests are supposed to bless the animals and slaughter them in a certain Old Testament prescribed way by letting the blood out in a certain way. They may even have, I know the Muslim ones, the imams have a special sword they use to let the blood out. I don't know if the Jewish rabbis do or not. But it is a certain practice of slaughtering and butchering and blessing that makes the meat acceptable for, according to Old Testament law, for the Jews.
Kosher pickles.
And I'm going, what would... They've been slaughtered and blessed by the priest.
I couldn't get my head around it. Okay.
Yes. And packaged according to certain Jewish religious practices that I couldn't even tell you what they are. All right. So this is only an example, the eating meat thing that he offers here. On the handout now, the theological term for what he's talking about is called adiaphora, things which are neither commanded nor forbidden in God's word. And the rule of love tells us not to make issues of those things which are neither commanded nor forbidden in Scripture. If God hasn't spoken to it, we shouldn't speak to it. If God has spoken to it, then we should speak to it. But even then, with patience, not with accusations, if possible. Verse 4, who are you to judge another's servant? To his own master he stands or falls. Indeed, he will be made to stand, for God is able to make him stand. So the master of the servant here is God himself. And he's the master both of the strong and the weak, both the meat eater and the vegetable eater. Each has to answer to him, not to each other. So I found this quotation in one of the commentaries I thought was apropos. This is a sharp rebuke. It is presumptuous when a weak brother sets himself up as if he were the one who is really strong, yea, as if he were the real master in the Lord's house. Even the beginning of such an attitude must be corrected without mincing of words. Paul is just as alive to the opposite danger and also corrects that, yet the paradox remains. The weak often do more harm in the church than the strong. That is, those who don't understand these things and want to force an issue that's an adiaphora on everybody else, that's what really creates problems in the church. I've had to go to congregations that are having disputes. And one in particular I was at, the issue was that certain elders were trying to force adiaphora matters on the rest of the congregation and on the pastor. The pastor had they didn't like the way he distributed communion, basically. And it was nothing wrong with it. It wasn't contrary to anything doctrinal. Many of the people liked the way he distributed communion, but a couple of elders didn't. And they tried to force on him a command, you have to do it this way because we don't like it. And then it was creating a conflict in the congregation. So I had to come in and try and resolve the conflict, identify what the issue was, that was the issue, and then teach them about what adiaphora means. If it's neither commanded nor forbidden by God, according to St. Paul here, back off and respect each other. You know, you can't force somebody into something that's neither commanded nor forbidden. And as soon as you make a law about it, it ceases being an adiaphora. As soon as you say, you got to do it this way, which is what they were doing, then you have violated the very heart of what an adiaphora is. An adiaphora is, God doesn't care, so we don't care. You can't say, it's an adiaphora, God doesn't care, so you're going to do it that way. So yeah, we had to have that discussion. And the solution was, the elder who was doing it got so mad he quit the congregation and went someplace else, and then there was peace. That was by his own volition, not because he was told to do that. Kind of an aside, my dad in World War II, one of his jobs as an MP was to also settle disputes, but a little differently than I had to. And his solution, he was given the task of figuring out what the conflicts were going on within a certain company. And his solution, which worked well, go in, find the main troublemaker, transfer him out. Immediate peace. Amazing how one guy can cause a huge problem in a church. And Paul had the same thing, obviously, in Rome. All right, getting back to it, verse 4. So who are you to judge? Okay, we did that. Read the handout. Asterisks on the bottom of page 2. It is not uncommon, then, for the one with the weaker position to be the most boisterous and forceful, and to be the first to make personal attacks against the opposition. They have to rely on something other than their bare facts to win, because the facts simply aren't on their side. So this happens a lot. Verse 5 and 6. One person esteems one day above another. Another esteems every day alike. Let each be fully convinced in his own mind. He who observes the day observes it to the Lord. He who does not observe the day to the Lord, he does not observe it. He who eats, eats to the Lord, for he gives God thanks. He who does not eat to the Lord does not eat and gives God the thanks. So now Paul introduces a second example of a spiritual adiaphora. What day you worship on. The first is foods, the second is the day of worship. And when you think about it, you can understand why this was an issue. Because a lot of the congregation in Rome were Jewish converts. Jews grew up worshiping on the Saturday Sabbath. The Gentile converts did not grow up with that tradition. The early Christian church, really from the very earliest days, started worshiping on Sunday. There are actually two examples biblically of this happening. If you look in Acts chapter 20, verse 7, you can see an example of Sunday worship. Acts chapter 20, verse 7. Now on the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul, ready to depart the next day, spoke to them and continued his message until midnight. Imagine a sermon going on till midnight? No surprise that we're also told that one of his sermons, one of the listeners fell asleep, fell out of a window, and broke his neck. I won't do that to you. We don't... Fortunately, we only have one floor. There's not far to fall when you're bored. Anyway, first day of the week, that's Sunday. So their first day of the week was a Sunday. When the disciples came together to break bread, that's a description of communion. Not eating a meal, that's the Lord's meal. And then the sermon. So the first day of the week already in Acts, which would have placed this in probably the mid-50s A.D., Christians are already worshiping on Sunday. There's one more mention, not quite as clear, but nonetheless seems by implication to be a reference to a Sunday worship, is in 1 Corinthians 16:2. Now, the day of worship is an adiaphoron. God never commanded you have to worship always on Saturday. Old Testament ceremonial law was Saturday worship, the Sabbath. Everything changes with the coming of Christ, who is Lord of the Sabbath. So the early Christians chose to recall the resurrection by worshiping on Sunday, not the Old Testament law by worshiping on Saturday. From what I know historically, originally, the early Christians even worshipped with the Jews. And they would still go, some of them would still go to the synagogue and to the temple on the Sabbath Saturday, some of the early Christians. Eventually, around 100 AD, the Jews threw the Christians out and forbade them to come anymore into the Jewish sanctuary, in which case they worshipped exclusively on Sunday. So early on in Christianity, it seems to have been kind of a combination with some of the churches worshiping on Sunday and other Christians still going to the synagogue and such on Saturday. So it was this mix. So Paul addresses that here and basically says, don't judge each other based on what day you're going to church. Doesn't matter. Any thoughts there? Okay. 6b, second half of verse 6. He who eats, eats to the Lord. Okay, so this could be a reference to the practice of fasting. Could also be application to eating certain foods like pork and vegetables, like the first discussion was about eating. But he who eats, verse 6, he who eats, eats to the Lord, gives thanks. He who does not eat, does not give thanks. Or he does give thanks, he just, you know, does it in his own way. So if you, this I think probably most precisely deals with fasting. Some people choose to fast as part of their religious devotion. God has not commanded us to fast. But we know Jesus did. We know the disciples did. We know this was a common Christian practice throughout the early centuries as part of their devotion. Fasting, going however many days they chose to go without food, as a devotional thing, as a way of recognizing and stating that the only food their soul really needs is Christ, and that they can do without the things of this world for a time. So it was a statement of faith. Some people did it, some people didn't. So Paul is again saying, don't judge people based on whether they are or aren't fasting. God hasn't commanded it. You want to do it? More power to you. You don't want to do it? That's okay too. So three different examples, really, we have of various adiaphora. Just don't judge based on things that God hasn't commanded or forbidden. That's the bottom line. Verses 7 to 9. For none of us lives to himself, and no one dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die to the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. And verse 9. For to this end Christ died and rose and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and the living. So here's finally the heart of it. This is the root principle governing all of these various issues, that this is about Christ. This is about the gifts he has given us in his death and resurrection. This is about his lordship and not about us. We don't live for ourselves. We don't die for ourselves. We're the Lord's. So it's about grace and mercy from Christ, not about us getting what we want. That's life. Verse 10. Why do you judge your brother? Why do you show contempt for your brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. This is another one of those repetitious things. When he says, why do you judge your brother? Why do you show contempt? It's the same thing. Their judging was contemptuous. A verse easily taken out of context. The context is condemning others for things that are not biblical. judging someone as sinning who is not sinning. So judging and despising or showing contempt are the same thing. This doesn't mean we can't call sin sin and can't condemn doctrines that clearly do stand contrary to God's word. But there's a difference between judging doctrines by God's word and judging individuals based on human opinions. So it is Wayne saying, don't judge others. It's in the context of adiaphora again. Don't judge people based on stuff God's word hasn't said. All right. Any thoughts there? Let's finish this up then for today. Verse 11 to 12, for it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me and every tongue confess to God. So then each of us shall give account to himself to God. This should be the focus. Are we in fact true to God, not worrying about pointing fingers at everybody else and how they are matching up? Deal with yourself, not with everybody else. In verse 13, therefore, let us not judge one another anymore, but rather resolve this, not to put a stumbling block or cause to fall in our brother's way. So this seems especially aimed at the Jewish converts who were putting a stumbling block of Old Testament ceremonial law in the way of the Gentile converts. And the very things Paul just got done talking about, the issues of food, the issues of the Sabbath, the fasting things, all of these were Jewish issues that were being forced on the Gentiles in the congregation. And the Gentiles were being judged by the Jews for not doing these things like a Jew should. So Paul here kind of is one last discussion with them. Quit judging people based on this. Don't put stumbling blocks in the way. Don't make up laws people have to follow just because that's your way of doing things. He says this business of a cause to fall in our brother's way. The Greek word, we've seen this before, is scandalon, scandal. That's the English equivalent. Literally, it is a stick for bait of a trap, usually a snare. So don't put a trap in somebody's way to catch them in something. It sounds, if you read it in a certain way, it sounds kind of like a legalistic list. Don't do this, don't do that. Quit judging, scolding. You know, it sounds legalistic. But when you consider the fact that Paul has framed this in the way of put on Christ, it's the outward actions that really are not meant to be law, but meant to be an expression of Christ within us. This is what it means to put on Christ. It means to not be a legalist and run around judging other people for all these other things. It means to love as one loves self. And we're very kind to ourselves when we slip up and make mistakes. We need to be as kind to others when they do the same. And not focus on sins and not make sins out of things that aren't sins. That's putting on Christ. All right, any thoughts, any comments, anything on today's section? All right.
So love is the fulfillment of the law.
Put on Christ. Let's close with prayer. Heavenly Father, we do confess that we do not always treat others as they ought to be treated and do judge unrighteously at times. We pray for your forgiveness and we pray that you help us put on Christ. Teach us what that means and help us daily to forsake ourselves and cling to him whose love has defined us and given us life. In Jesus' name, amen.